Thanks very much for giving me this opportunity to talk about our progress. And my name is Qian-Hao Liu. I'm a PhD student from the streaming group at USTC. So it's difficult for me to attend the meeting on site. So today I will give a presentation online to talk about the precision measurement of the molecular hydrogen. The molecular hydrogen is one of the simplest and calculable multi-electron systems. The ground state of the molecular hydrogen can be precisely calculated with the AB initial method. This calculation includes relativistic theory, QED, and a few fundamental physics constants. Therefore, their accurate spectroscopy measurement combined with the equally accurate calculations of their energy levels will allow us to test the fundamental interaction theories and determine the physics constants or even a problem for new physics. And in addition, in the hydrogen system, there are a lot of isotopes and also the substitution will allow us to test the fundamental symmetry, such as order and the pattern H2. So our work is based on this background. Some mistake, sorry. Oh, so the motivation of our group is the fundamental test in the molecular hydrogen systems. Here, I show a table about recent results of the dissociation energy of the molecular hydrogen and the transition frequency of the HD. Although the theoretical treatment for the HD is the same as that for the H2 and the D2. You can find that there is a much larger discrepancy between the experimental and the theoretical result. For the vibration transition of the HD, such as R2, P2, R0, we found that there is still a discrepancy between the theory and the experiment. So more efforts are needed to resolve this discrepancy and improve the accuracy. On the other hand, if under a certain accuracy, the theory agrees with the experiment, we can test one of the fundamental physics constants, the proton-to-electron. Which means when we get a relative uncertainty of this transition to 11 jitters, we could derive the constant with the uncertainty in the same order. Currently, the best two results of the proton to electron mass ratio are from the penetrative experiment and the spectrum of the molecular HD ions. This graph I have shown here is the comparison of the R1 result in the last 5 years. We can see that there is about 2 sigma discrepancy between the experiment and the theory. And there are also non-negligible discrepancies between the different experiments in 2018. The most recent results seem not quite agree with each other in the data analysis. So in order to determine the center frequency more accurately, we would like to measure this transition another time. Currently, even though the HD transition is very weak, so people can measure the saturated absorption spectrum of HD with the cavity-enhanced method. Compared with other cavity-enhanced techniques, we plan to use the cavity ring-down method. The principle is quite easy. We can detect the decay time of the laser inside this high thinness cavity when we suddenly cut off the laser. And the intra-cavity power is in the high thinness cavity is sufficiently high, maybe up to 200 watts. And the sensitivity is good enough to obtain the saturated absorption signal. So in addition, the method has no modulation and demodulation process, which will allow us to better understand the line shape. To get a better signal and a narrow line width, we measure the HD spectrum at low temperatures. From the modulation strength of the Doppler-limited spectrum, we know that at 18 Kelvin, we get almost a factor of 10 enhanced signals. The low-temperature CRDS setup is shown here. An ECDL operating at around 1.4 micron delivers three beams. The first one is locked to the optical cavity with the PDH method, and the second one with the most of laser power enters the cavity for the ring down measurements. And then the third beam is for the metrology. The beam is beating with an optical frequency comb, and the feedback signal is sent to the piezo to control the cavity length. Consequently, the cavity mode frequency and also the laser frequency is stabilized by this comb. We control the function generator to scan the laser frequency and get the spectra. And the sample cell, the red one in this figure, is connected to a two-stage cryogenic cooler. It's the black one to produce the cold HD sample. So to insulate the optical cavity from the mechanical noise generated by the cryogenic cooler, we separate the ring down cavity mirrors with the sample cell and damp the vibration with the several stage bellows. Yeah, and this is the picture of our setup we built in 2019. As you see, there is a cryogenic cooler here, and inside this chamber is our ring down cavity. Yeah, it's that. And this is the optics in this figure is our signal with an asymmetric line shape compared to the normal saturated absorption spectrum. Obviously, it's not a Lorentz profile. Next, we averaged more than 3,000 spectra, and then we get this spectrum in this figure, the red curve. Although the signal is weak at a low temperature, but we still get a good enough signal to noise ratio.
Qian-Hao, may I interrupt a moment? We suggest that you turn off the camera, your own camera, because
Can you see me?
Yeah, but turn it off because we have a bad connection and you're falling away.
Yeah. Okay.
So,
to make a comparison, the result at room temperature is shown with the black curve. Different from the conventional lamp deep spectrum, the measured spectral profile has an asymmetric line profile. So almost at the same time, our colleague, Professor Zhou from the Department of the Quantum Optics at USTC developed a theory to describe the asymmetric line shape. He claims that a weak transition can be perturbed by a strong transition, even if the two are very separate. In the HD system, we can see that the frequency of the electronic transition is 12 electron volt. So it's much larger than that of the vibration transition, but the Einstein coefficient of the target transition is 14 orders of magnitude smaller. So as a result, the perturbation is not negligible. By using the pure quantum optics method, Professor Zhou and his team calculated the behavior of the HD in a standing wave field considering the perturbation state. The calculation shows that the far of the resonance state in the standing wave field introduced a pure particle AC stark frequency shift to the target transition. Yeah, it's that. And it seems that the transition has been modulated. And based on this corresponding Hamiltonian, Professor Zhou can calculate the relative effect, and the detailed result can be found in this archive paper. And the full numeric calculation of the Doppler spectrum is shown here. We can see that the influence of the electronic state has no effect on the Doppler spectrum due to the Doppler broadening of hundreds of million hertz. But in the saturated absorption spectrum, it's not negligible. You can see clearly the asymmetric line shape. Unfortunately, from this theory, it's rather difficult to calculate the line shape of the spectrum completely, because the final function is a mathematical expression for the asymmetric profile. So we can use the final function to fit the spectrum. This we call the final model is as follows. And S is the intensity or strength, and X0 is the center frequency. Gamma is the full width at alpha maximum, and the Q is the parameter describing the asymmetric character of the profile. And the most important factor Q is related to the modulation amplitude from the far off resonance state and the interaction time between the light and the molecules. So we use this model to fit the spectrum where G is the Gaussian function describing the Doppler broadening absorption background. Mu is the laser frequency, and the mu zero is the transition center frequency. And this set is the depth of the saturated absorption. Si and Xi are the relative intensity and the frequency shift for each hyperfine component. And the gamma zero is the full width at half the maximum of the saturated absorption, which is dominated by the transit time broadening. And the Doppler profile is fixed according to the calculated values under the experimental conditions. Si and Xi values are fixed as those given in the reference. And this reference and the mu zero, Q, gamma zero, and the D set are free fitting parameters. Here, we assume all hyperfine components in the fit share the same final factor Q, and the fitting result is shown in this figure with the red curve. Considering the correlation between the parameter Q and the mu zero, we also fit the spectrum with a varying Q value within a range of plus and minus three sigma around the fitted Q. And the results are shown in this blue black in this figure. So we can see a considerable change in the fitting residues, resulting in a change in the mu zero is the plus and minus the 24.5 kilohertz, which could be a conservative estimation of the parameter decoupling uncertainty of the mu zero value. So we also did the same things without considering the hyperfine splittings. And the fitted curve is shown in this figure as the black one, which overlaps with the red curve, and no considerable difference is found in the resulted residues and the parameters. Any asymmetric profile may introduce a frequency shift to derive the systematic frequency shift in the final model. We compare the the numeric center frequency with the final model. We can see from this figure that zero on the horizontal axis is the center of the transition. And the blue dashed line is the fitted center obtained by the final model. Obviously, the fitted center shift is the smaller value. And the shift is related to Q and gamma. And finally, due to the character of the perturbation state and the light field. Also currently, it's difficult to know all the information from the perturbation state. So we can derive the frequency shift from the numeric calculation and the final model fitting. We use various perturbation amplitude to do the numeric calculation and fit the calculated spectra with the final model and get a series of the parameters Q, gamma zero, and delta mu. The results are shown here. We can see that the absolute value of frequency shift delta mu is increased with the absolute value of the final factor Q. It's being consistent with our theory. The Q and the gamma zero values obtained from the experimental spectrum is marked as the red dot in this figure, which is correspondent to a frequency shift of -111.4 kHz, which should be corrected for the transition center frequency. And the uncertainty of the frequency shift is 12.4 kHz, which is mainly from the errors of Q and gamma zero, well shown in this figure. So our uncertainty budget is here. We conclude an absolute frequency for the HDR transition of this value with the dominated uncertainty from the parameter decoupling and the line shape model. Other contributions to the uncertainty budget are discussed and shown in this table, include the recoil effect, collision shift, hyperfine, Zeeman effect, and so on. And our new value of the R1 and the most recent experimental and the theoretical result is presented in this figure. The new measured result is still not consistent with the theoretical value. And the result of the Hua, this one, after correction with the present model, is given beside the previous report value. And outstanding result derived from this work by -384 kHz or 6.6 times the standard deviation because a different treatment of the asymmetric line shape was applied. With low temperature Catherine Dunn special system, we can measure another transition in this vibration band, the R0. R0 is more likely to be determined a better accuracy. Owing to the population distribution in the ultra low temperature, such as 20 Kelvin, the R0 signal can be further enhanced. On the other hand, the hyperfine structure is much simpler than the R1. And this is the first spectrum around 0.3 Pascal. It's the black one in this figure. And you can see also there is an asymmetric profile. When further reducing the pressure, we can see a structure within this line profile. We reduce the temperature about 10 Kelvin, and this structure is still here. Yeah, this one. We think different hyperfine transition in the R0 may have a very different perturbation amplitude, resulting different Q values. So it's necessary to calculate the electronic transition strength from the all hyperfine levels involved. And our work is still in processing. So I think Joseph Wilk will talk about it later. we think the HD transition frequency can be determined to a few kilohertz after further understand the line profile. To determine the fundamental constant, we need a better relative uncertainty. A better choice is to go to a high vibration band. For example, the vibration quantum number is 0.24, and it will not lose the measurement accuracy. Then the relative uncertainty will be a factor of the two better. Use the directive measurement of 0.24 turns out to be difficult because the Einstein coefficient is super small. However, it's possible to access the V equal to zero with the double resonance method, similar to the saturated absorption. It's a kind of the sub-Doppler spectroscopy, which can greatly improve the accuracy of the center frequency. So to do the double resonance measurement, the two lasers need to be on resonance with the same optical cavity. And meanwhile, the laser need to be on resonance with the two transitions. Due to the dispersion of the optical cavity, it's difficult to meet all the above conditions. However, we can use the Doppler effect by choosing the molecular velocities. Two lasers interact with the molecule at the same time, resulting in a spectrum. For example, the frequencies of the two lasers are denoted at omega 1 and omega 2, which are locked on the two cavity modes. And the frequencies of these two lasers are shifted from two molecular transition center by this and that. So when we change the cavity length, the omega 1 and omega 2 is changed synchronously. And you can find the molecule with a certain velocity to resonance with the lasers. So
Qian-Hao, are you almost at the end or you're going way over time?
Maybe several PPT.
Could you conclude from here?
This is our double resonance result. We obtain a preliminary result in HD using a wavelength modulated cavity enhanced method because the signal to noise ratio is a bit better than the cavity ring down spectrum. And we use the V-type double resonance spectrum of the P1 and R1 measured and shown here. So this is our spectrum. To make a summary, we build a low temperature calm log cavity ring down spectral setup and measure the R1 transition to this value. Currently, we are focusing on the determination of the R0 transition in HD and the double resonance spectrum of HD. In the future, we will detect the vibration fundamental of molecular hydrogen in a different band and the vibration transition of HD in a molecular beam by using a different technique to see if we can improve the accuracy of the HD transition. So my report is finished. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you very much, Qian-Hao, for this contribution. There's a question here in front.
Right. So maybe first a comment, then a question. The comment is that the line shapes in the vicinity of forbidden transitions in cavities were studied first, or maybe not first, in the context of parity violation. So for instance, in Carl Wieman's cesium parity violation experiment, he observed highly asymmetric line shapes and developed the basic theory. And then it was further studied in ytterbium parity violation as well. So I wonder if these references are familiar to the authors and if it's the same or not. It seems that it's very similar.
Sorry, I don't follow your question. You mean the I don't follow your question. Can you?
Yeah. If this was not clear, then we will send you the comment by Dima Butkor. Yeah, we will send that later, because otherwise it's probably going to take too long. Is there any other questions? I would have a question myself in between. So did you attempt to measure the P1 transition? As you will see from the next talk, that would have a different line shape predicted and measured from a dispersive one. Did you attempt that to measure a P1?
Yes, we have measured the P1, but the signal to noise is too low because the transition and strength is very low. Maybe signal to noise four or five, and it's a final profile.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.